أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم إن الله يحب التوابين ويحب المتطهرين. In our discussion on Tawbah, we started with the issue on reality of Tawbah. That Tawbah is not just words. In reality, it should be reflection of the inner change, the spiritual transformation which should take place within us to move us from the sins closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yesterday, we looked at the crucial role of Tawbah in our salvation in the hereafter. If there was no door of Tawbah, we were doomed for sure, because we were not given the infallibility and the isma. Tonight, I would like to talk about the first instant of Tawbah in human history. If you look at the story of Adam alayhi salam, we referred to it briefly yesterday. Again, you know, that story of Adam before he comes to the earth has many, many dimensions in it as far as, you know, understanding the reality of human being in this dunya and the consequences in the akhirah. Adam alayhi salam from very beginning was created not for Jannah, for this earth. إِنِّي جَائِلٌ فِي الْعَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. That is the announcement Allah made to the Malaika. I'm going to appoint my Khalifa on the earth. So Adam was created for this dunya. However, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was not bound by any deadlines. So Adam was created and Allah says, you know, be my guest. Enjoy. You know, he was there for some time and probably, you know, Allah thought, you know, he looks very lonely. And so Allah created Hawa. So now Adam and Hawa are there in the garden of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was not their final abode, the reason for the creation. And so as guests of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah in very early stages in ayat 35, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْنَا يَا آدَمَ اسْكُنْ أَنْتَ وَزَوْجُكَ الْجَنَّةِ. O Adam, you and your wife, you know, live here, stay here, dwell in this garden. وَكُلَا مِنْهَا رَغَدًا حَيْسُ شِئْتُمَا. And you can, you know, eat whatever you like freely. Everything is open to you. وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذَهِ الشَّجَرَةَ. But there was one exception, one prohibition, that do not go close to this tree. If you do that, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, you will become from the ظَالِمِينَ. ظَالِم has different meanings. One of the meanings is to put yourself into harm. So Allah says, if you do this, number one, the prohibition is don't go near this tree. But if you do that, means don't eat the fruit of that tree. If you do that, then you will put yourself in harm and difficulty. And this is where we see, you know, then Shaitan approaches Adam and Hawa together. And the rest of the story, you know, they ended up, you know, eating that fruit from the forbidden tree. فَأَزَلَّهُمَ الشَّيْطَانَ عَنْهَا فَأَخْرَجَهُمَا مِمَّا كَانَ فِيهِ. The Shaitan made them sleep from that garden. And then he got them out from that state of felicity in which they had been. And so basically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to them, that's it. You know, you could have stayed here longer. Everything has been provided for you. But by doing what you did, you put yourself into difficulty. Your guest term for my, you know, guest house here has been terminated. Now you go where you're supposed to go, to the dunya. And there, nothing, everything is free there. You'll have to work to provide for yourself. I'll give you the resources, but you will have to work. Here, you didn't have to do anything. وَقُلْنَا اِحْبَتُوا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌ. And Allah now is addressing Adam, Hawa, and Shaitan, that all of you go down. And you are enemies of one another. So this is being declared from day one, Before even Adam comes to this dunya, remember shaitan is your enemy. وَلَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَرٌ وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَىٰ حِينٍ. And on this earth, this is your abode. That's why I created for you. And the necessities of life is there for a fixed time, as long as each one of you lives for your own fixed time. Now, this is where, very briefly, I would like to go to the discussion we had in Ramadan before the last 2 years, when I was talking about shaitan as the open enemy. So I'm just using this slide from 2019, where the question comes up, did Adam commit a sin? Because we believe that, you know, anbiya are ma'soom, they are infallible. So how do you explain this, you know, disobedience in that way? And this is where we have to realize that the commands are of two types. One is known as legislative command, other is known as advisory command. Al-hukm al-mawlawi is the first one. Al-hukm al-rishadi is the second one, the advisory. For example, if the command comes and says, you know, do not eat pork, that is hukm al-mawlawi. Legislative command from the master, you know, to the slave. Don't do this. And in this case, if you disobey, it is a sin. It is a dhamb. But when it comes to the advisory command, for example, you know, the parents or the teacher said to the children, it is snow outside, it is winter, don't go out without a jacket. And the child goes, I'm not talking about small ones, 15, 16 years old, goes there, plays, comes back, now he has fever. Disobedience of that advisory command does not make him sinful, but he's going to suffer. Because now he is not feeling well because he went out without the jacket. In the first case, if you disobey, it's a sin, and the consequences is the azab and the punishment in the akhirah. In the second case, it is not disobedience, but it has consequences, but the consequences would be in this dunya. If a doctor tells you this is the medication you should take for your own, you know, illness, and if you don't do it or don't take it according to the timing and the way he is asked, what happens? Your problem is still there. Can the doctor now take you to the police that he has committed a crime? No. He has disobeyed the doctor's advice and put himself into difficulty. And this is where we see that when you talk about, you know, what Adam alayhi salam did, first of all, there was no Sharia. The Sharia only came after he came to the earth. Actually, the ayat after that is what we'll discuss now, but the ayat even following that is the ayat where again Allah says, now go down. Now I'll send you guidance. We looked at it yesterday. Whoever follows the guidance will be rewarded. Whoever doesn't follow the guidance will be punished. And so this whole issue of guidance, disobedience, obedience, consequences, is what is going to happen in this dunya. And so that's as far as, you know, the issue of, you know, whether Adam committed a sin or not. Let's now go back to that issue. Although it was not a sin from the technical point of view, Adam was not just a human being. He was Nabiullah. With that status, even violating advisory command is not appropriate to that status. And that is where, you know, Adam feels remorseful. And this is where he does Tawbah. This is known as, you know, At-Tarkul Awla, means abandoning the action which was appropriate to that status of that person. And for Anbiya, Tark Awla is possible, but committing a sin is not possible. So this was the first case of, you know, disobedience on an advisory level. Adam felt remorseful. He hasn't seen anyone doing this before. He hasn't seen anyone how to ask forgiveness. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching him. This is the first tawbah we see in history of mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, helped Adam by teaching him how to do tawbah. And so the ayat goes on. فَطَلَقَّ آدَمَ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ. So Adam received some words from his Lord. Receiving here is basically being taught. Now he is taught some words, and he uses those words in asking forgiveness and tawbah. فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. This is the first time in history that the word taba is being used. This is the word for tawbah. إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. So taba عَلَيْهِ is Allah here. Allah turned to him with mercy and forgiveness. إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Tawwab also is tawbah, and tawwab are from same root. Indeed, he is forgiving and merciful. So the word tawbah has two dimensions. When I say atubu ila Allah, it is a human being basically turning towards Allah in repentance. When the Quran says, Allah taba ilayhi, Allah did tawbah towards him, it means Allah turned to him with forgiveness. So we turn to Allah with repentance, and Allah turns towards us with forgiveness. Now, it is Tuesday night. We had a dua before this. That was the reason I chose this for tonight. The question is, when Allah says, فَتَلَقَّ آدَمَ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ, Adam received some words from his Lord. What were these words? I can give you a long list of ahadith about it, but I'll just dispense here with only two. One from a Sunni source, another from a Shia source. What were these words? Now, there are different kinds of ahadith about it. Some of them are very similar to the dua of Prophet Ayyub, you know, we're praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when you put all this collectively, you come to realize that, you know, you address Allah at that time. But then there is something else. Suyuti is a very Sunni, a very famous Sunni mufassir of Quran, and his tafsir is based on what is known as tafsir rivai, based on the narrations from the Prophet, of course, according to their point of view. And he basically has compiled different kinds of ahadith under this ayat. One of them he has from Abdullah ibn Abbas, where he says, سَعَلْتُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. أَنِ الْكَلِمَاتِ الَّتِي تَلَقَّاهَا آدَمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. I asked the Prophet about the words that Adam received from his Lord, and then the Lord taba alayhi, turned to him with forgiveness. The Prophet said, Sa'ala, Adam asked for forgiveness. By what words? Sa'ala bihaqqi Muhammadin wa Aliyin wa Fatima wa Hasan. وَالْحُسَيْنِ إِلَّا تُبْتَى عَلَيَّ. In the first tawbah, the issue of tawassul is coming in. We yet have a problem with that. Just go and study the first tawbah. And this is a Sunni source from Abdullah ibn Abbas, where the Prophet is saying, he asked in my name, in the name of Ali, in the name of Fatima, in the name of Hassan and Hussein, that, oh Allah, you know, forgive me, fataba alayhi, and I'll come to this. What does it mean? This was a Sunni source. From the Shia source, we have Sheikh Saduq. In his collection known as Ma'ani al-Akhbar, through his chain of narrators going all the way to Sa'id bin Jubair to Abdullah ibn Abbas. Same narrator who is there in the Sunni books, also in the Shia books, but from different chain of narration. He says, سَعَلْتُ النَّبِيِّ عَنِ الْكَلِمَاتِ الَّتِي تَلَقَّاهَا آدَمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِ I asked the Prophet about the words that Adam received from his Lord, and Allah turned to him with forgiveness. قَالَ سَعَلَهُ Again, same words. بِحَقِّ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلِيٍ وَفَاطِمَا وَالْحَسَنُ وَالْحُسَيْنِ إِلَّا تُبْتَ عَلَيَّ Allah, I ask you in these names, that you forgive me. فَتَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ Allah turned to him with forgiveness. Salawat. The Prophet is the last Prophet. He is not yet born. Fatima is not yet born. Ali is not yet born. Hassanain are not there. So what is all this? This is the first question we'll get. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, when it comes to the issue of the creation, even the souls of all human beings were created before. You know, our spiritual existence has been there on the level of ruh and nafs. Nafs, ruh is known as nafs when it is put into the body. The soul by itself, without the body, is called ruh. When it goes into the body, it becomes nafs. There are ahadiths that we have from Shia and Sunni sources where there is a very famous statement, even Sunnis in general accept, where the Prophet says, أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورِي The first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created was my nur, my light. Not the body. The body came later on. The physical existence came centuries after Adam. But the nur of Muhammad was the first creation. And he says, with the barakat of my nur, Allah created everything else. أَوَّلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورِي And therefore we see that, you know, even in the story of Adam alayhi salam, when he looked around, he saw the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he saw five lights and anwar over there. And he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whose lights are these? And this is where he was told, this is the nur of Muhammad. This is the nur of Ali. This is the nur of Fatima. This is the nur of Hassan. And this is the nur of Hussein. And he was actually taught these names in the earlier story. When the Malaika objected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why you are you know, making a human being your representative and khalifa. We praise you, we worship you, you know, we are more worthier. Initially, Allah says, I know, you don't know, just be quiet. Then he organized a kind of a competition between Malaika and Adam. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءِ And Allah taught names to Adam. Not only of these five anwar, many, many other things. Then he asked the Malaika. And that is where Allah was able to justify the position of Khilafat for a human being, that I have given him the knowledge and the potential of knowledge. You only know whatever I give you. You don't have the ability to, you know, investigate and, you know, increase in that. And so this is where we are talking about the first Tawbah in the human history. And it was with the tawassul of Ahlul Kisa, while they were still in the spiritual form. I'm sure I'll get the accusation, oh, this is all ghulu, exaggeration. And this is all batil. Let me quote to you Allama Tabatabai, you know, the greatest, you know, commentator of the Quran during our time. And this is actually the first volume in English, which was translated by my late father. And there, in both cases, when he talks about Adam, Allah teaching the names to Adam, as opposed to the Malaika. And then in this ayat that we are discussing, فَتَلَقَّ عَادَمَ مِن رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ, that Adam received certain words from his Lord. Look at Allama Tabatabai, what he's saying. He says, it means that those names could cure all the ills of humanity. The angels understood it and surrendered to the knowledge and wisdom of Allah. We have earlier explained that those names were sublime creations, hidden from the heavens and the earth. They were intermediaries to convey the grace and the bounties of Allah to His creation. No creature would be able to attain to its perfection without their assistance. At this stage, we may refer to some traditions which say that Adam saw the figures of Muhammad and his Ahlul Bayt, not in a physical sense, as a nur, and also their light at the time he was taught the names, and the one who mentioned, and the ones which mentioned that he saw them when Allah took out his offspring from his back, and the others which describe him seeing them in the Jannah. This is actually referring to the this ayat that we were discussing, ayat number 37. Going back earlier, when he talks about teaching Adam, this is ayat number 32 of Surah Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught the names to Adam alayhi salam. Allama Tabatabai quotes a hadith from Jabir ibn Abdullah, from the Prophet, that the first creation was his own nur. And then Allama Tabatabai makes the following comment. He says, they are numerous traditions of the same kind. And on deep pondering, they support what we have written earlier. Some of them will be discussed later on. And this is the point. You should not reject such traditions outright, thinking that they were forged by the Sufis, or if I may replace with the word common these days, that they were forged by the ghulat or the extremists. No. The wonders of the creation are unfathomable. The scientists and the philosophers have spent and are spending their lives in discovering some of its secrets. But every solved enigma brings in its wake a lot of fresh, previously unthought of enigmas. You come to discover one new thing, and you realize that 10 more things you don't know. Do not forget that this is the unfathomability of this physical world, which is the smallest in range, the narrowest in scope, and the lowest in rank. How can we pass judgment about other worlds in the heaven and the nur beyond this, the worlds of light, spaciousness, and abundance? End of quotation. Salawat Pranayak Parar. And so when we talk about this issue of the first Tawbah in the history of mankind, even there we see this issue of, you know, Tawassul is there. Although physically Muhammadan and Muhammad were not there. Only their anwar were there. This actually gives us the ability to understand that after the wafat of Rasulullah, after the shahadat of the Imams, and Bibi Fatima, or the Shuhada, if we call them, because whenever you present all these ayat and ahadith, they will say, well, it's valid. It is only valid when Rasulullah was alive. But to use him as a wasila when he's dead is futile and wrong. I'll ask you, what about Adam? Muhammad was not even born yet at that time. He is doing tawassul through the nur of Muhammad, through the nur of Ali, through the nur of Fatima, through the nur of Hassan and Hussein. They were not yet physically there. Their anwar were there. So even if they are physically not here, they have already passed away. Their anwar were before that, and their anwar are still there. And so when we... And so when we do the tawassul now, we believe it has its own impact and its own power. This is no exaggeration. It's not a ghulu. We are not putting them in the place of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our dua is still to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we say, bihaqq Muhammadin wa Aliyin wa Fatima wa al-Hasan wa al-Husayn. And that's the reality that we had to realize. And that's why I wanted to mention this whole story of the first Tawbah in the history of mankind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our amal, increase our tawfiqat, forgive our sins. With the barakat of this holy month and the zikr that we do of Quran and the Ahlul Bayt, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep especially his true followers under his protection and send down peace and tranquility to the whole world and the humanity, and may he hasten the appearance of the Imam of the time, Ajjalallahu ta'ala Farajul Sharif.